George Bayonets! When was the bayonet invented and by whom and why? Hi folks, Matt Eason here, Scholar Gladiator. Now, the answer to this question is not as simple as you might think. Most people will think the bayonet, they think of the term Bayonne, the city in France, which I've been to, it's very nice by the way, in the Pays Basque, and they would think that this is a French invention. In fact, lots of websites you'll find do say that, but it's not as clear cut as that. The fact is that the bayonet comes out of necessity, okay, and that's why in this video we're also going to look at why? Why was the bayonet invented? Now, before I go on, I just want to briefly say that you will, of course, be familiar with different types of bayonets from different periods. We start off with the plug bayonet, but more about that in a minute, and it goes through to socket bayonets, as seen here. Again, we'll come to that. And it finishes up with types of knife and sword bayonet. Here's a World War I example, as found or mounted on the SMLE, British rifle used in World War I, which many of you will be familiar with. There are shorter varieties that were used in World War II and still used today, of course. In the 19th century, as well as the socket bayonet, there were other varieties that came along, like the Yatagan bayonet here, with a blade modelled on the Turkish Ottoman Yatagan. Originally, these seem to have come along because, of course, if you're muzzle loading, so the muzzle ring goes through here, then it means that the point is out of the line of your ramming hand coming down, so it's quite a useful shape. But additionally, there was a French guy called Colonel Mary Mong, who was a big advocate for the Yatagan blade used as a weapon in the hand. So for numerous reasons, Yatagan bayonets from about 1840 were used, particularly in Britain by sergeants, but in France they were used by all troops for a period of about 20 years. More than that, actually, more like 40 years. And we even find more exotic varieties like this Pioneer's bayonet. Now, this is massive. You might think that's a huge thing to have mounted on the end of an already big and heavy musket or rifle. And yes, it is. But these, of course, could double up as sidearms. It's essentially a cutlass. And indeed, there are naval cutlass versions as well. So sailors had types with a cutlass guard that you can mount on the end of a naval firearm, usually a carbine, usually a shortened rifle, a bit shorter than the infantry's. But this is a Pioneer's one, which has essentially got a knucklebow guard rather than the cutlass hand guard. It's got a straight blade, so it's still effective for thrusting with a spear point, but you'll notice it has a saw blade along the back. So this can be used as a tool, it can be used as a weapon in the hand, a short sword, or it can be used mounted on the end of a rifle for fighting, you know, in a battle, essentially in line with the rest of the infantry, or indeed for repelling cavalry. So they come in a huge variety. We're not going to look at that in this video, and I suspect that lots of you watching this video will know that. Okay, so the most common types of bayonet historically, you could say, or the most certainly the ones most people are familiar with, are the knife bayonet, as used extensively in World War II and ever since, and the socket bayonet, which has a socket and a sometimes defined as a zigzag kind of bar at the side, so that the point is offset. So again, you can take your ramrod out here and you can muzzle load the gun. That becomes less of a necessity when you get breech loading guns. But is it as simple as the standard kind of, it was invented in France and everybody copied it? The answer's no. In fact, the history of the bayonet is more complex than that. So who actually invented it? Was it one group of people, or was it lots of people collectively? And why did they invent it? Now, as a dealer in antique weapons like these bayonets, I regularly have to photograph them, and I'm always looking to increase my skills and my photography skills and my ability to represent the objects that I want people to appreciate and hopefully buy as well through my website. And Skillshare is a website where you can gain all sorts and brush up on all sorts of skills. Skillshare is an online learning community with thousands of courses. It's about improving your existing skills or learning completely new ones. So as an antique weapon dealer, I am always looking at new ways I can improve my business, and particularly in terms of photography as well. I find that great photographs tell a great story and also help with your sales fundamentally. The latest course that I've been looking at is one run by Sean Dalton, who's a travel photographer, and the course is called Still Life Photography: Capturing Stories of Everyday Objects at Home. As well as giving you a whole bunch of pro tips. It's also really great that the way the course is constructed in a way that you actually take photographs as you go through the course with Sean. Your day to day is filled with tasks and endless to-do lists. Prioritize your self-care and wellness by using Skillshare as a way to invest in yourself, unwind and relax. Skillshare is ad-free, so you can stay in the zone while you're exploring new skills. It has new premium classes launched every week, so there's always something new to discover. And the entire catalogue's now available with subtitles in Spanish, French, Portuguese, and German. So my special offer, only through this channel right now, is if you check out that link below, for the first 1,000 people of you, so this is only for 1,000 of you, so be quick, for the first 1,000 of you, you will get 1 month's free trial of Skillshare, completely to check out all of the content and enjoy as much as you like. So it'll cost you nothing, check out that link right now. So back to bayonets. Now, first of all, rather than we go into the why, we'll look at the where and when. Okay, so where were bayonets invented and when? Well, first of all, we have to talk about the word bayonet, okay, which clearly means a thing from Bayonne in France. So therefore, a lot of people take the simplistic approach of this was a thing invented in Bayonne. Well, sometimes words and names come to be used and come to be associated with an object. That doesn't mean that they were necessarily created there or invented there first. It's clear that there was a type of knife or dagger that was being made in Bayonne. However, if we look at the earliest references, they're not actually clearly describing what we'd now know as a bayonet. That is something which can be attached to the end of a firearm. The earliest references we have talking about bayonets actually just describe a type of dagger. While the term bayonet starts to appear in the 16th century, that is the 1500s, it's not clearly describing something which attaches to or enters or goes into or is used in conjunction with a firearm. It seems to just be describing an edged weapon. And indeed, if we look at Cotgrave's Dictionary of 1611, it describes a bayonet as a type of pocket knife. And in fact, what it describes actually sounds like a penknife. It describes it as having an assortment of blades. So in that case, even in 1611, we're already into the 17th century there, it seems they're not really describing something explicitly that attaches to a gun. You'd think in English, if they wanted to describe a edged weapon that attached to a gun, that would have been the first thing they would say about it. But no, indeed, it just says that this is a type of knife. Moreover, from the beginning of the 1600s in Europe, we don't really have any representations in art or archaeology or anything else or text that suggests the use of an edged weapon which attaches directly to the firearm itself. So we don't have any evidence for the bayonet as an object, and in fact the evidence for the bayonet word is not associated with an object that attaches to a firearm. Additionally, in 1655, Pierre Borel talks about the existence of bayonets, and again he talks about a type of dagger that's made in Bayonne, but there's no mention of it attaching to a firearm, even though by this point there were indeed edged weapons which attached to firearms. So the bayonet as an object by 1655 did exist, but Pierre Borel doesn't say that a bayonet is what that is. So what we've got here is a problem. We've got a problem of the terminology, the word bayonet, and the object of what we know a bayonet to be now. And it seems that, at least in Europe, in the early 1600s, at some point in the early 1600s, objects which attached, edged weapons which attached to firearms were invented. However, if we look in the early 1600s, the word bayonet doesn't seem to be associated with those objects. The word bayonet seems to only describe a type of dagger or knife that is made in the city of Bayonne. Now, as we get towards the middle of the 1600s, around the 1630s, 40s, indeed we know that plug bayonets existed, and I'll talk a bit more about bayonets and their use in warfare in Europe in a little bit. But let's try and answer this question of where and when do bayonets, plug bayonets in this case, that is a bayonet that literally rams into the barrel of your gun. So if I just take this socket bayonet, this off, this is a later invention. Okay, socket bayonet off. So imagine you've got a muzzle loading firearm, and for whatever reason, we'll talk about the reasons in a bit, you want to have a edged weapon attached to this as quickly as possible. One of the simplest ways you can do it, bearing in mind that this is a solid steel tube and fairly strong in itself, you take your dagger, essentially essentially, which has a tapered conical-like handle. You stick it in the end, you give it a bash, you maybe give it a twist to make sure it's securely fixed, and you've now got a spear. Yes, indeed, you can no longer shoot your firearm. However, remember this is a muzzle-loading firearm, where in optimum conditions, you're only going to be shooting 3 or 4 shots per minute. So if we're now in close melee combat, you're not going to be reloading anyway, okay? So you've now got a weapon you can use in close range. You can use it as a spear, as a polearm. Obviously, you can hit with any part of it, but primarily the thrusting is going to be the important part. So that's a plug bayonet. When were these first invented? Well, the answer might surprise you. So, I only found this out recently, but there is a Chinese treatise, that's right, a Chinese treatise, which I think is called Binglu, although my pronunciation is probably horrible, and it dates to 1606. Now, this is earlier than any that I've found, anyway, European example of a plug bayonet. And it is explicitly and clearly a plug bayonet in a Chinese military treatise. Moreover, it describes why this thing existed as well. And the answers are sort of obvious, but we'll look at those in a second. So it is a plug bayonet. Essentially, you've got a matchlock musket. So in China, in the 16th century, in China and Japan, as you know, firearms had already come in just as they had in Europe, and they were hugely changing warfare. However, you've got a slow rate of fire. Most, although some, and in China they did have some early breech loaders, as we did in Europe as well, but most of them were muzzle loaders. But whether it's a breech loader or a muzzle loader in this period, it's still a relatively basic piece of machinery, and it has a relatively slow rate of fire. And because of a lot of people with hand weapons and the nature of warfare at the time, they needed to have a musketeer who was able to defend themselves with a weapon. Now, let's just break out for a second and add a little bit of context in here. So for those of you who don't know, for most of the 16th century and for a good part of the 17th century, in most parts of the world where firearms were used, because the firearm operator, much like a crossbowman, is quite vulnerable to cavalry attacks or to just massed infantry charge with hand weapons, because of their slow rate of fire, it is important that they are either protected or able to protect themselves. And so the standard doctrine was to have a group of people, musketeers, operating muskets, be it matchlock, flintlock, whatever, with loading and firing, while another group of people usually protected them, usually with pikes. So you might hear of the era of pike and shot. And the era of pike and shot basically means those who operate firearms and those who operate spears and pole weapons to protect them for the most part. Now, obviously, if you've only got half your men who are operating pikes and half your men who are operating firearms, if you can find a way to combine those two things, everyone's a winner. You've doubled your firepower, and potentially you've doubled your hand-to-hand combat troops as well. Now, let's come back to the Chinese treatise. Now, the Chinese treatise is very, very interesting because it specifically describes why you would want to stick a plug bayonet in the end of your barrel. And it talks about essentially coming up against bandits, so presumably people who are more numerous, or indeed just coming into melee combat. Interestingly, it doesn't, as far as I'm aware, mention defending against cavalry. And I've noticed when talking with people who are used to 18th and 19th century warfare, even 17th century warfare, that there is a perception that the bayonet was designed primarily to defend against cavalry. And I think that's a little bit narrow-minded. Okay, I don't think it's wrong, but I think it's too narrow. Yes, that's one of the things that bayonets were designed for. However, fundamentally, if we boil it down to its fundamental building blocks, what it's there to do is to give the person who's got a firearm, which is not a very good hand-to-hand combat weapon, a better hand-to-hand combat ability. And that doesn't matter whether it's against a man on a horse with a sword or a lance, or whether it's against a bunch of bandits who are just steaming in with kitchen knives, okay? The simple fact is that people operating slow rate of fire firearms are very vulnerable to anybody charging in. Doesn't matter whether they're on a horse or whether they're on foot. or indeed if it's in buildings, a built-up area, a jungle, a swamp, whatever. So fundamentally, this is not necessarily about just defending against cavalry, it's about defending against anybody. And that could be another bunch of people with muskets who've decided, well, we're going to charge in with our knives or our short swords. The fact is, the rate of fire at this period wasn't enough to, like in the 19th century, to mow down charging people with hand weapons. The 21-foot rule, guys. So you need something to be able to defend yourself in that scenario. So while the earliest so far found and documented example of a plug bayonet, bear in mind this is a socket bayonet, not a plug bayonet, I don't own a plug bayonet unfortunately, but a plug bayonet, which essentially is a dagger that you jam into the end of your muzzle, while the earliest known example is a Chinese military treatise from 1606, does that mean that the Chinese invented the bayonet? Not necessarily. So this is where it gets a bit complicated. So sometimes absence of evidence is not evidence of absence. And the fact is that there is some hints that maybe already around the year 1600 in Europe, people were starting to also think about this question. And this is one of the points I really want to get across in this video, is that what I think we see here is convergent evolution, okay? Bear in mind that firearms had only been a major part of warfare, whether it's in Europe, whether it's in China, Japan, wherever, they had only been a major part of warfare, muzzle-loading firearms, for about 100 years at this point, okay? Yeah, we could say firearms come in the 1400s in Europe, however, there weren't massed ranks of people using firearms really until the 1500s. So they hadn't been around for a huge amount of time. And the simple fact is that the same conditions affected people, whether it was in Japan or whether it was in Germany or England or China, the same conditions affected all of them. For about a century, they had been operating muzzle-loading firearms and coming in the same circumstances and the same predicaments. And I think that they had all come to a conclusion that there was an advantage to have some kind of spike you could add on the end of your weapon. And so I think the plug bayonet, whilst it was clearly invented in China by 1606, bear in mind if it's in a treatise in 1606, it was probably invented at least a decade before that. And I think that we probably see a similar thing in Europe. We know that plug bayonets were around by the middle of the 1600s in Europe. They weren't common, but they existed. So therefore, I think they appeared some decades before that in limited numbers. And in fact, we know that certain people in the mid-1600s were actually issued with plug bayonets. So we know that they had been around for a while. They weren't a brand new invention, and they weren't an instant game changer, I have to say, as well. In the mid-1600s, it was still normal to have pikemen and musket men. But I think what we see here is convergent evolution. I think it's a very simple, easy fix for the problem of how does the musketeer defend themselves. So as stated, whilst through most of the 17th century, or certainly the middle of the 17th century, the standard operating procedure for armies was to have people with muskets and people with pikes protecting them. By the 30 Years' War, so the middle of the 17th century, we know that plug bayonets were in some limited use. And indeed, there's a rapid, Jean Martinet was important in France in instigating the use of plug bayonets as regulation. And in fact, we see in England as well, the plug bayonet starting to become regulation for specific groups of troops in the 1670s and 1680s. So really, how it panned out was plug bayonets were being used in limited numbers in the middle of the 17th century in Europe, but by the late 17th century, particularly the 1670s onwards, plug bayonets more and more started to become a standard piece of equipment. And of course, this led to the gradual abandonment of the pike or pikeman. This was great for the military authorities, of course, because it meant you could give a standard armament to all of your troops. You didn't have to think about pikes and pikeman armor for that group of troops, and then muskets and musketeer uniforms and hats for that group. You could now give them all the same equipment, very good for supply and economics, but also it meant that in battle, you had one type of soldier now. You had one type of soldier that had a gun and a bayonet, and they could therefore protect themselves, or they could storm into buildings at bayonet point, do a bayonet charge, this kind of thing. And so this is really the period when we see the beginning of the bayonet charge, the idea of shooting your gun and then going in with hand weapons. Now in Britain in 1689, something very important happened, and that was the Battle of Killiecrankie. And this was part of the Jacobite uprising. So during the Battle of Killiecrankie, which I suggest you go and search, because it's a very interesting conflict and very important, certainly in British history, the forces of William of Orange were overwhelmed by the Jacobite Highland forces. And the way that the Highlanders fought in that battle was essentially, and this was a typical Highland charge, if you've ever heard of the Highland charge. So they did the typical thing of firing their guns. So obviously they used the landscape, they used the lay of the land. It's actually quite a complex battle in many ways, but essentially their tactics were to sneak up on the royalist forces and then get within a good shooting range, but only fire one shot for the most part. So they didn't stand there reloading. So the government forces are essentially, or the royal forces, are essentially standing there, they're giving a volley fire, then they're getting their shot out, they're reloading, they're ramming, they're doing everything they need to do, they're cocking, then they're firing another volley. This is fairly slow, of course. So what the Highlanders decided to do to overcome this was to basically charge in, do one volley or one shot, probably independent fire, they didn't fire even as a volley, one fire, and then drop the firearm, pull out their, this is the only sword I've got to hand at the moment, but pull out their sword or axe or kind of lockhaber axe or whatever they're carrying as a backup thing, and charge in. And it worked. It worked fantastically, in fact, and the Highland charge was extremely effective at Killiecrankie. And the sources suggest that one of the reasons it was so effective, bear in mind that the William of Orange's forces were using plug bayonets, which they have to ram down the muzzle of their gun. Now, if you're ramming down your, if the way of deploying your bayonet is to ram it down the muzzle, then you can't keep it mounted while you're firing. You're either firing, or you're using your bayonet, one or the other. You can't have the plug bayonet mounted and still fire. Or certainly, you could fire the bayonet out maybe, but you can't reload. So the problem was, and the sources suggest that what happened is they were standing there in line firing. The Highlanders charged on them so quickly, they didn't have time, at least as a concerted and unified force, to get their plug bayonets in. So they're left with basically a fairly heavy and unwieldable firearm, fighting against people who are charging in with broadsword and targe or lockhaber axe or whatever. So they were just overwhelmed. They were completely swarmed and defeated. It was a very categorical victory. So shortly afterwards, they started to look at the idea of a type of bayonet that you could have mounted on your firearm, on your musket, and have it mounted while you were reloading and firing. And they came up with essentially the socket bayonet. Now again, as to who invented the socket bayonet, this is probably open to some debate, although generally speaking, British people do claim ownership of this. But the socket bayonet, also known in the period as the zigzag bayonet, because it goes like a Z almost. The advantage to this is you can keep it on your musket at all times. The reason it has this zigzag is, of course, because you need the muzzle to be clear to shoot, but also importantly, the muzzle needs to be clear to be reloaded with the ramrod. So you take the ramrod out of here and you need to be able to get that down the muzzle. Now, an interesting detail, I think, which a lot of people don't necessarily know, is that the bayonet tends to curve slightly away as well. So it's a slightly odd angle on these things, because you don't want to be ramming your charge home and smash your hand into the end of your bayonet and stab yourself. So they have to have firstly an offset socket, and then usually they have a slightly curved out blade as well. And you'll notice this example from the 19th century on an Enfield rifle actually has an asymmetrical point as well, so it's actually scooped away there, so it's taking the point as far away from the hand as possible. That does mean that whilst you can thrust this way, often the thrusts were given that way with the firelock or the mechanism up at the top here, so it's more in line with your thrust, otherwise it's kind of curving off to the side. Minor detail. But this this meant that they could now keep their bayonets fitted and be ready for hand-to-hand combat at any moment, still be able to reload, still be able to fire. An important detail is this later version has a locking mechanism of it on it. So once you've turned that, you can't get the bayonet off. Earlier versions did not have that, and the bayonet could be pulled off the rifle, which is something which occasionally happened in combat. It's mentioned in India in the 18th century. So that the locking mechanism was the final kind of detail that made the socket bayonet a completely finished entity. And the socket bayonet stayed in use until the modern world. It was still being used in the 20th century. So the final part of the bayonet story that I'm going to tell in this video is around 1697, the Peace of Ryswick, I'm not sure how to pronounce it. After that, it seems that both the English and a lot of the German states essentially abolished the abolished pikemen, did away with pikemen completely, and the socket bayonet by that point was completely standard. So as we go into the 1700s, you've got huge armies, whether it's France, Germany, England, wherever in Europe, who've basically adopted by that point the zigzag socket bayonet. And this really changes warfare because it means, as I say, there are no more pikemen anymore. Everybody has a musket with a bayonet on it. But moreover, because the bayonet is usually permanently fitted in combat at this point, it means that at any given point, your forces can give a bayonet charge. So they are no longer, the musketeers are no longer the people who stand there stationary, reloading, firing. You can instantly turn them into an aggressive attacking and ground capturing force, or indeed building capturing force, because they've got their bayonets fitted and ready at all times. Is the bayonet a fantastic hand weapon? No, I think there's some mythology about the bayonet. Because of course the bayonet is one of the hand weapons that has survived in massed use, you know, commando daggers and Gurkha kukris aside, it's one of the weapons that survived, hand-to-hand weapons that survived into the modern world, and is still sometimes used. Even in Iraq, there was a couple of British bayonet charges. Bayonets are, and there was a very famous one in the Falklands War in the 1980s. So that bayonets are still used in the modern world occasionally, not very often, but occasionally. And therefore the bayonet has an almost mythological power to it. But in the 18th century, with relatively slow loading, muzzle loading firearms, the bayonet was a very potent weapon, especially when you consider the nature of the recruits who were often being used in these armies. They often weren't necessarily the most trained or most experienced forces, and if you had an experienced body of troops who had fought in a few campaigns and were happy to use their bayonets, if you come up against a bunch of fresh recruits who are fine to reload their guns, they know how to reload, they know how to shoot, they might even have a good rate of fire, and you charge them with bayonets, the chances are they might run away. And so therefore a lot of people say, oh well, there weren't huge numbers of casualties caused by bayonets, and I've always argued that's not important. What's important is the bayonet, all the way up to World War I, and even in some cases World War II, used by the Japanese, the bayonet took ground and held it. So you don't necessarily need to kill enemies. If you make them run away, then that's still the goal achieved. And indeed, even in the modern world, it's sometimes used for crowd control and things like that. And again, it's not killing people, but it's doing a job that the firearm can't do by itself. I hope this has been interesting and maybe slightly informative. I was very surprised to find out the first known example of a socket, of a plug bayonet, is in China, 1606. In time, we might find comparably early or even perhaps earlier examples in Europe. I don't think the Chinese invented the plug bayonet. I think it was convergent evolution, because I think having a bayonet on a muzzle-loading, slow rate of fire firearm is a necessity, certainly in the warfare of that period, whether it was China, Europe, Japan, wherever. And I think the evolution to a socket bayonet made an awful lot of sense. And finally, the knife bayonets and sword bayonets that came along later are really just an evolution of the socket bayonet. At the end of the day, they have an element which goes around the muzzle, they have an element which attaches to the side, so they are offset. They are basically a type of socket bayonet in use. The only difference is they have a hilt or a handle on them, which means that when you dismount them, you can also use them as a knife, a sword, a saw, or whatever. But fundamentally, as a bayonet. They're essentially a big bulky type of socket bayonet. So I hope that's been useful and interesting. If you haven't liked this video already, then please go and click that like button, and if you're not subscribed, please consider doing so. Thanks for watching. We've got extra videos on Patreon. Please give our Facebook a like and subscribe if you haven't already. Cheers, folks.